Okay, this is our topic for today. Who is Bernie Dehler? Who am I? I'm an unknown person to most people probably in the world. So I'll give you a little bit of background. I was raised and confirmed as Roman Catholic. I'm going on 53 years old, just to let you know some of my history here. Through high school, I was a Catholic. In college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian, thanks to Campus Crusade for Christ. We got a bunch of these people here. I was one of those. I preached the gospel on the TV and the internet through a Christian ministry I founded called freegoodnews.com. While I was working in the computer industry, I went to school part-time also and got a master's in ministry degree in 2007. In 2009, after arguing with Christians, because I used to debate different people of different faiths, and a Christian or atheism was just another group to debate, I became an atheist because I found out that their arguments were superior, in my opinion. So I became an atheist in 2009, and I'm active in local atheist and secular leadership groups. For example, I founded a group called the Center for Philosophical Naturalism for people who want to learn more about a naturalistic worldview. And when you give up religion, how should you think now? So I try to help people with that. Is Christian belief conducive to doing good science? My answer is no. And in fact, to restate that, just to be more blunt and obvious, I'll say Christian beliefs harm the cause of science. So I want to go on the attack here, and I want to shock you. So, and I'm going to defend this, so make it interesting, right? It's not going to be boring, I hope. Here's, most people will probably find this funny. You know, I think it's a funny joke. I think everybody probably sees this. I mean, here's a scientist saying, here's my hypothesis, here's all my equations, and the middle is, well, a miracle happened here. So the other scientist says, well, I think you should add a little bit more detail here in step two. So why is this funny? Because of course, you can never do this in a science course, ever, right? Your professor would flunk you, you can't do anything like this. You can't say a miracle happened in your scientific hypothesis. My claim is that every single Christian does this. Every single Christian, even Ted. If you're a young earth creationist, you'll say, hey, humans didn't come about through common descent. God made this as a special action. Boom, there was a miracle right there. Maybe things were happening before that, but boom, there's a miracle. Ted probably accepts, I think he accepts evolutionary theory that humans evolved from animals. He probably accepts almost all of science, or maybe even all science. But you heard him talk about there's these questions. Where did everything come from? All you can answer that, that's evidence for God. Boom, let's put it at the very, very start. A miracle occurs, that's where we get math from. Where do we get math from? Where do we get physics from? From a miracle of God. So he just pushes it all the way back there. So the most literal Christians are the young earth creationists. They move that little miracle happens up here, but the people, the more science you accept, you just move that thing back. And you have to do that if you're a Christian, because if you don't, then that means your God is natural. And if your God is natural, he doesn't exist, because what's there to do? If there's nature explains everything, what do you need a God for? So you're forced as a Christian to have that miracle occurs. So my approach to this debate is I could go at it two ways. One is look at how Christian beliefs harm science in the everyday life. For example, people who say, hey, I'd prefer to do faith healing, and their children die. This happens in Oregon. We've had parents have their children die because they want to treat them with faith instead of, you know, medicine. The second way of attacking this problem is looking at the grand scheme of science. That is, science is all about moving the frontier of knowledge about what we know about the world. And that's the one I want to focus on, because number one is too easy, and number two is very important. Okay, so especially, you know, you college kids are trying to formulate the way you think about things. That's all, I'm going to try to look at the big picture here. So here's a deductive logical proof. I said Christian beliefs harm science. Prove it. Okay, here's a proof. It's a deductive proof. I got two premises and a conclusion. So the first premise is, number one, if God created something through supernatural methods, then science can't figure it out. I think everybody probably agrees with that. In other words, if God said, boom, there's a miracle, humans popped up, of course you can't figure out from science how it happened, because it was a miracle. So number two, all Christians believe that God created something from nothing using supernatural methods. Yeah, you can probably argue with that, and that's what the rest of my presentation is going to be about, fleshing this one out. Number three, so if number two is true, number three I think is true, therefore all Christians believe that science can figure some things out. Because if all Christians believe that God did something from nothing using supernatural methods, then science can't figure it out. So I'll just expand on that a little bit. Again, here's that cartoon. I think you should be more explicit here in step two. Let's take again a young earth creationist who says God made humans by magic. Boom, he spoke it into action. It's an incantation. He said, let there be, and there, boom, there was, there's humans. Or he made it from dirt and breathed life into it, or however he made it. Okay, so if science is unable to figure this out because, let's say that's the way it really happened. Science is unable to figure it out because if humans really were made that way, science can't figure it out because science is only going to cross using natural means. Therefore, it'd be futile and stupid for a scientist to try to figure it out because there's no answer. But what happens is the scientists, of course, they assume there is a natural process, and that's how they have so much success. It turns out that they're finding answers. So stated negatively, we can say all Christians have beliefs that are not conducive to doing good science. But since doing good science is kind of the same as increasing our knowledge of the world, because that's the whole point of science, is to understand the world better. We're trying to comprehend what is reality. That's the whole enterprise of science. I would make a positive statement saying what I do believe, not what I don't believe. Positive statement is, therefore, all Christians have beliefs that harm our ability to gain new knowledge about the world. Here's an example, and I said this is likely something Ted Davis will say, and I think he did say this. The universe seemed, and I, of course I changed the words a little bit to make it a little bit more sillier, but I mean, I think this is what he's saying essentially. Number one, the universe seems to be fine-tuned for human life. I'm not sure if he used that exact argument, but he might say there seems to be mathematical equations that are amazing. It's impossible to explain this naturally. He actually said that. He can't explain these things naturally. There's no natural explanation for these. Well, if you can't explain it, obviously God did it. That's the leap. It doesn't follow. Just because you can't explain something doesn't mean it's evidence for your side. It's not evidence for either side. In logical fallacies, that's called the appeal to ignorance. When you say, can you explain this? No. Well, therefore, it's evidence for my side. Maybe we will discover an answer, like we did for other scientific questions. Sometimes earlier humans said, what causes lightning, earthquakes, and tsunamis? And now we know that lightning is caused by electrical differences. Tsunamis and earthquakes are caused by plate tectonics. Maybe another answer is that we'll never understand it because our brains are too simple. For example, in quantum mechanics, we cannot comprehend entangled particles, how they work. The thing with entangled particles is that you can have one particle affect another particle, even if you remove it by many light years, and nothing travels faster than the speed of light. So if something is light years away, it means it takes a year for that light to travel. But if you have these entangled particles and theoretically move them light years apart, when you modify one, the other one modifies. It's a complete mystery in science. Nobody understands it. Some of the physicists says it's like we don't understand anything. We don't even understand the fabric, basic fabric of reality here. So there's a lot we don't know. So don't glory in like, oh, we don't know, therefore, you know, we know almost everything. If we don't know it, then God did it. There's a lot we don't know. We don't know about dark energy and dark matter, and almost all the universe is made out of that. I think it's like 95%. They call it dark because they don't know what it is. The degree of harm that done to science from Christian beliefs depends on what your Christian theology is and what the science is. So for example, if you say, I'm a scientist and I'm studying the effects of radiation on the body, there's no conflict because the Bible doesn't make any claims on that. If you say, I'm a young earth creationist and I'm studying supernova explosions, you got a big problem because in modern cosmology, there's a supernova that was 12 million light years away, which means it took 12 million years for that light to travel there. But they think the universe is only 6,000 years old. Obviously, the light can't be traveling for 12 million years if the universe is 6,000 years old. That's 100% conflict. So those are the kind of the mixtures. This is just some background on an observed supernova. There's quite a bit of information on a bunch of different supernovas. on the internet you can find. Evolutionary creationism is the least conflict with modern science. They're the smartest group of Christians. I went through all the stages. I went as a Christian. I was a young Earth creationist, an old Earth, and then ID. Finally, evolutionary creationist, and then finally said, "Hey, it just makes sense to be an atheist." This group here, this evolutionary creationist, they and Dennis Lammer basically wrote the book on it here. They basically accept all science. You know, there's no conflict with the Bible because the Bible is not a textbook. It's not a science textbook. So whatever science tells you, believe it. How does that work with your theology? Well, sometimes they just punch and say, "Well, go ask a theologian." That's not my problem. That's like Francis Collins, you know, he says, "This is evolution. Well, how do you explain this in theology?" Well, go ask a theologian. So there's very little science conflict other than, like I said, they still say, well, there's unknowns like where did laws of physics come from? We don't know, we can't figure it out, therefore God did it. Huge philosophical conflict, so even though there's no scientific problems with evolution, for example, huge philosophical conflicts come into play now. For example, with the problem of evil. It's always been a difficult problem for Christians to answer. How come there's such incredible pain and misery in this earth if there's an all-loving, all-powerful God? And now you want to accept evolution. Well, I'm going to explain how that makes it even worse. And if I wanted to stay this way, I found out I couldn't do this. I couldn't be this kind of Christian. And the reason why is because basically what I saw is that they leaned on this logical fallacy of appeal to emotion. Basically, it's all about Jesus. It's about praying to Jesus, getting good feelings from Jesus and your prayer life. Read the Bible for what's good. If you read the Bible and there's a problem, any kind of problem, just put it in the back of your mind. You know, someday you'll go to heaven, all your questions will be answered. Forget about the problems. Focus only on the good and the lovely. That's all you do. And it's like, no, I can't do that. That's not intellectually honest. That's not looking at all the data and dealing. Like, I think, I don't know if it was Faraday you quoted, but sit at the feet of facts and let it teach you. Instead of sitting at the feet of God, sit at the feet of facts and see what it teaches you. Like I said, the problem of evil is greatly magnified after accepting evolution. There's supposed to be an all-loving, all-powerful God, and if he, you know, people like Ted, I think he accepts evolution. To think about this, that, you know, they say evolution is red in tooth and nail. There's an all-loving and all-powerful God who created everything out of the messiest, meanest system you can imagine, which is evolution. Here's a quote from the Smithsonian. "Extinction is the complete demise of a species. It takes place when all individuals of the species die out. Extinction has occurred throughout the history of life on Earth. It is the ultimate fate of all species. In fact, it has been estimated that 99.9% of all species that have ever lived on Earth are now extinct. Not 99.9% of all animals that ever lived, of all species that existed. This is almost every single species. Why is God making T-Rexes and all these weird and strange animals and they just all go extinct? It's way before humans even, so it's not, you can't say sin caused it, human sin. And I found, too, that Christians are afraid to ask questions. You know, in church, of course, you can't talk about some of these in a lot of churches. They're just taboo subjects. Can you admit, you know, I asked Ted, can you admit to your fellow Christians that Noah's Ark is a myth? That, you know, they say that there was, all humans were killed except for 8 saved on the Ark. We know scientifically that is a myth. Scientifically, for sure, it's a myth. Can you admit that humans evolved from other animals? It's a scientific fact that humans evolved from other animals. There's a theory of evolution trying to explain how it happened, but that it happened is a fact. People, some like Francis Collins, are Christians, evangelical Christians, and they fully accept it, but they get, you know, a very cold shoulder from most Christians. And if you want to ask me in the Q&A time, I can tell you, a lot of people think, oh, the Catholic Church doesn't have a problem with it, but they do have a big problem also with evolution, going back to Adam and Eve beliefs. Okay, so, you know, also, if there's evolution tells us there's no such thing as a first human, there's no such thing as a first fish, first rabbit, first anything. And so, of course, this does a lot of havoc on your theology for Adam and Eve. There is no first Adam and Eve. This is Ted's a professor at Messiah College. This is a statement from his science department. Okay, he says there's no problem between science and religion. And look at his own college. Okay, I got two slides here. This first slide is not very bad. Nothing really objectionable here. It says, within biological sciences department, there is no single interpretation that all faculty would endorse, nor should this be surprising. Indeed, the college expects faculty to form their own positions thoughtfully and to communicate these to our students in appropriate ways. In this way, we can offer our students multiple models for relating science and faith, which parallels what we do in other academic disciplines. Now let me show you the killer. Part two. We believe it's especially important to do this with science, as it reflects a genuine, legitimate diversity of opinion within the Christian community, and better equips students to evaluate information that might not fit neatly into one particular model. College library holdings, which are extensive in the area of science and faith, include many representative examples of each major position found within the Christian community today. These would include young earth creation, often called scientific creationism, varieties of old earth creation, including progressive creation, continuous creation, and theistic evolution, or evolutionary creation, and intelligent design. Young earth creation here is called a genuine, legitimate diversity of opinion. I mean, this is if you say it's in church, of course you can get away with this. But if you say it's in academic circles, this is a scandal. Young earth creationism, that the universe is 6,000 years old, it's just as bad as saying there's a flat earth. It's just as ridiculous. And this is not only tolerated, it's called a legitimate diversity of opinion. And old earth creationism also is anti-evolution. It believes that humans were made in a special creation instead of descending from other animals. This is also a scientific fact taught in every university, state university. No state university teaches young earth creationism or old earth creationism in science. But here a Christian school does. Why does a Christian school do it? This is how Christianity harms science. They're teaching their kids this. So anyway, some people say they read the Bible 20 times and they're really, you know, some people are impressed by that. I'd be more impressed if you read a critical thinking book. And this is one that they use in a lot of universities. It has an interesting title, but it tells you how to evaluate different hypotheses, you know, like creationism versus evolution. I'm not gonna have time to talk about this, but the burden of proof is when you make a claim, you need to bring evidence for it. If I said, here I am, Jesus, I return to the earth, you should say, show me some evidence, and rightfully so. So, you know, if you believe in a supernatural world, we all agree there's a natural world. If you want to say there's a supernatural world, bring some evidence. And there is no good evidence for it. So I'll just give what I call an inspirational summary, okay? As an atheist, all I can offer you is reality. There's no replacement for a false hope and eternal life. I mean, just to say bluntly, you have to grow up and face the fact that you're mortal. When you die, you go back to nothingness from which you came. You know, for example, like a child that believes in Santa Claus, you can't say, well, I'm going to teach them something else because they're going to have their feelings hurt when they don't believe in Santa. Let me give them something else to believe in that will give them free presents. Sorry, there are no free presents. When you lose your belief in Santa Claus, you can really be hurt as a child. But there's no substitute except for reality. You know, that's not real. That's the same way it is here. It's just accepting reality. But the blessing of reality is you don't have to be perplexed when bad things happen. You know, if the child dies from cancer or there's a car accident and somebody you love dies all of a sudden, how'd that happen? Where's God? There's no mystery if there is no God. It makes perfect sense. The Lord's ways are not mysterious. They're non-existent. And you can really start living and experiencing life instead of some of the people who go way off the deep end, like the Muslims, and you know, they don't care about this life. Let's kill themselves and others. Because they'll, you know, get paradise and there are 72 virgins or whatever, you know. Heaven is the most ultimate Disneyland and hell is the most ultimate torture chamber, you know. Ultimate good and bad. But when you drop all that stuff, you really start to see how precious this life is and how to experience it. There's a lot of, you know, of course there's a lot of preachers too. I think there is a flood of people leaving the faith as the internet and people are sharing their stories. Here's one of the most recent ones, Ryan Bell. He's coming out with a bunch of information now. He just left, and I think there's an interesting quote he had that he said, I used to want a closer relationship to God, and now I just want a closer relationship with reality. So I'll end with that. Thank you.